Well, good afternoon. It's my honor and pleasure to have been invited to this session. I am, by the way, one of those students that Bob funded. He funded me since I was doing my PhD, and I'm very grateful to that. But today I'm going to talk about a little bit about him, and then about the work that we have done. Okay, so the first statement I want to say is that with the loss of Bob, we really lost a great champion and a visionary. And a lot of people don't know this, especially the new generation, the young people who attend these conferences, but a lot of the work that's being done right now in non-equilibrium plasmas and their applications were all things that Bob funded early on, and he pushed. And here I list, this is not an exhaustive list, but the atmospheric pressure plasmas and air plasmas, you just saw a book that was written on that. The use of a lot of people nowadays, you go and see all these nanosecond driven plasmas, and probably have no idea that Bob program was behind that to increase the chemistry in those plasmas. Nanoseconds were developed in a Mounir program that Bob was funding. The discovery of the guided ionization wave, which is now called plasma bullets, was done under his program, and the applications of all kinds, including biomedical and combustion and things like that, Bob has funded. So you can see, when you attend all these sessions in this conference, he has his influence on a lot of the topics that are going on today in non-equilibrium plasmas. So today I came to talk about the biomedical application of low temperature plasmas. And this is an amazing statement that Bob said in 2000. So for especially people who just joined the biomedical. And you can read it. It says, a quiet and dramatic revolution is invading the ultra-conservative domain of Western medicine. Virtual guerrilla bands and visionary physicists and engineers are threatening to overturn the conventional wisdom and challenge common practice in field held hostage for centuries by chemists and biologists. But we love biologists. They help us. So we will examine the historical scientific roots of this insurgency, comment on its current manifestation, and speculate about its exciting future. And the future is today, as many of you know. So Bob said these words back in ICOPS 1998, I believe. No, 2000, ICOPS 2000. So you can see what a visionary he was just by reading a statement like this. I had the honor of recognizing him when I chaired ICOPS 2010, and I gave him a plaque because of his support to our field, which is plasma medicine. So that was really my pleasure and my honor to have done that during that conference. He also worked very hard to spread the word also. And you can see, we got our heads together back in 98 when we ran the first small little oral session in ICOPS. At those days, there was no biomedical application in ICOPS because the XCOM has to approve everything, right? So we sneaked it behind XCOM with Bob's help, and we had only three talks at those days. Only three oral talks and few posters. But today you can see this is a non-exhaustive list of conferences that all have plasma medicine in them. And the last two here, the number eight International Conference on Plasma Medicine, which is a full-blown conference. The last one was just last week in Japan. And the last one, which with the help of a colleague of mine, we just started this year, International Workshop Plasma for Cancer Treatment, which was held on DC 2 months ago. So Bob would be very, very happy to see how this is progressing. All right, so outline of my talk. First, I'm going to talk about why plasma. A lot of people ask me that question, why plasma? And inactivation of bacteria, which we started with. That's when Bob was supporting that. And we you know, progressed all the way to do work on cancer, and also some effects on healthy cells, that's for wound healing. And I'll conclude and give you a little bit of a timeline. Let me know when I'm 5 minutes, because I think I prepared too many slides. These are my contributors. Some of them are faculty members, some are students, some are postdocs. Without them, none of this work that I'm going to present will be possible. So I'll show you a little picture of all the plasma, the cold plasma that we developed with Bob's support. So with Bob's funding, we were able to develop all kinds of sources for this biomedical application. So why plasma? Well, plasma has a lot of advantages, which is especially give us reactive chemistry at low temperature. We are able to produce all these wonderful radicals and chemicals that we can produce at low temperature. These are just an example of these radicals and these molecules that we can generate with, but there are hundreds of them, as many of you know. But I thought I'd just give you a little bit of example. So what do they do? Well, the reactive oxygen species, and I listed a few, they are well known to do peroxidation of lipids, oxidation of protein and DNA strands, and what have you. Reactive nitrogen species are involved in, for example, cell signaling. So plasma produce an environment that can interact with biological media. And that's what that statement says. So in this picture here, I don't know if I have a laser pointer, but you can see here the cell. This is the outside world. This is the inside of the cells, and this is the lipid bilayer and the proteins that are embedded. Thank you very much. That are embedded in there, and plasma will come from the outside and react with this either by oxidation or even starting some signals that will be transmitted later through many biochemical pathways inside the cell. So, let me put the whole thing here. So this is an example of these plasmas, and we are trying to move from the Middle Ages to the 21st century using plasmas. So because until today, a lot of these wounds, diabetic wounds and all that, there's no way they can deal with them, and we still have to, you know, do amputations. So plasma can kill, and kill the bad things, hopefully, right? And then plasma can heal also, and I'll show you some examples. And the toolbox, it has basically this reactive species that we can generate at what we call biologically tolerant plasmas, which is temperature 40 degrees and less. I'll give you here a timeline, and I showed how where Bob Barker jumped in way early on in 1997. We did our first experiment. I was at the University of Tennessee at the time. And then after we published it, and I had a lot of discussion with Bob before that, and he found a way to provide us funding when nobody else wanted to hear us. They all, plasma and biology, this guy has lost it a little bit. So nobody would listen to us. But Bob was, he saw the benefit, and he said, I still remember, he said, give me some time, I'll find a way. And started funding us in 1997. And here shows you the timeline, how things have progressed. We went through several stages, and including even destruction of protein that caused neurodegenerative diseases. And we started about 2011 to work on cancer. So it's been actually 20 years since we've been doing this work, and you can see a constant progress and a constant expanding of the field. So let me start with the bacteria. You can see here the number of new resistant antibiotics is going down, while the antibiotic resistance of bacteria is going up. So we got what I call a real and present crisis, and you hear about this everywhere, even in the news, including in the medical field. So the latest news I read was just not long ago, 30 April 2014, antibiotic resistance global threat. This is from the WHO. So you can read this. I don't have to read it for you, but it is a big problem because bacteria have learned to resist our antibiotics. So the bacteria type that we worked on, this is in the early days. So you can, bacteria come in two types, gram-negative and gram-positive. The gram-positive can become spore-like and they are very tough to kill. And these are gram-negative, they don't do that, but they both can be very dangerous and pathogenic. The early work that Bob funded us, we showed very clearly how atmospheric pressure plasma can kill bacteria in a relatively short amount of time. And then later on, Bob also funded us to develop these plasma jets. And we did a lot of work, especially on medical application using our plasma pencil that we developed also with Bob's funding. You can see here treatment of bacteria with the plasma jets. These are inactivation zones. And these are other examples from E. coli all the way to the cholera bacteria. And I want to move on to, that was the early work. And then in the last maybe 10 years or so, I started working on actually mammalian cells. And I'm going to show you a few results about cancer cells and also healthy cells. I don't want to get into the biology too much and compare the two cells because I really need about 2 hours for this talk. So I better move on. So I very quickly here show you some of our protocols that that we use. But our workhorse is our plasma pencil. I think my first slides will show you the killing of cancer cells. Some of our first experiment we did was on leukemia, which affects a lot of children and grown-ups, but it's a big problem with children. I show you here a picture of leukemia cells and how they look like when they are multiplying. And here I show you after treatment with different times with plasma how we can eradicate this leukemia cells, cancer cells, which are aberrant to white blood cells that keep multiplying and cause a lot of problem to people. So you can see here in a matter of a few minutes we kill them, and if we wait with time, which is kind of a delayed effect, they keep dying even after the plasma. We treated them and we wait 12 hours, 24 hours, 36 hours. And these are a few examples just to show you that they do die. We published this in the Physics D. I'll show you some microscopy pictures. These are the untreated leukemia cells. The way we know they are dead, we put a dye, it's called the tripen blue, and do the exclusion assay, and when the cells are dead, the membrane are ruptured and they become dark. So all the dark cells here, these are dead leukemia cells. All the ones that are still kind of clear, those are live cells. I think I showed you that. All right, this is another example of a metastatic prostate cancer taken from a patient's brain. And this is the control, how they are, and then we treat them 1 minute, 6 minute, 10 minute, and we see that we don't get too much killing, a lot more resistance. However, if you wait and look at the, after you treat them, and you wait up to 48 hours, you can see that some of the cells start dying. This is kind of delayed effect. It is a process by which cells die called apoptosis versus necrosis, when you kind of blow them, basically their membrane and leak everything, versus apoptosis where they die, what's called programmed cell death, with our cells do it naturally. So and that's the best way to do it, so they don't release any toxins. 5 minutes, okay. And you can see after 48 hours, even the resistant prostate, metastatic prostate cells in the brain, we were able to kill those. And you can see here some microscopy. These are the untreated cells. And these are the cells that start having what they call blebbing, and these cells here are dead by apoptosis. This is another cancer. This is a carcinoma. Scaber, this is a cancer from a patient intestine. These are the cells, how they look like, these cancer cells. And we treat them at different times. And we look at them from 0 hour after we treat them all the way to 72 hour. And you can see that as you wait, we get really excellent kill of this carcinoma cells. So this delayed effect is telling us a lot of what's going on, that there is a lot of not brute force. This is not, we are not killing them by brute force right after treatment, but it's a delayed effect because the cells basically is committing suicide on its own later, like our normal the normal cells die. This is some morphology. These are the treated cells versus, for example, here all these black colored cells. These are the cells that died after 5 minute plasma treatment and 72 hours later. All right, I better go fast. There's another application which is for wound healing, where you want to kill the bacteria, but you don't want to kill the healthy cells. So we did some on fibroblast cells, and you can see this is the how they look like, and then when they are not treated, so how they normally look like, and this is 10 second treatment with plasma, 30 second, they still look pretty healthy. So up to 30 second, we don't damage those cells. However, if you wait longer, about 1 minute or 2 minutes, you treat them, 1 minute or 2 minute treatment, then you can see it's a lot of damage. So that tells us the threshold of treatment. So because we don't want to do harm, right? We want to kill the bacteria but not harm the healthy cells. So that gives us a threshold of dose of plasma that we can apply. I can show you also, these are different kind of cells called the epithelial cells, which is in our epithelium. Here, the same thing, we see after 5 minute treatment, then we have major damage to them, which is bad. So we know that if you look here at the summary graph, from 0 to 5 minutes, we have good survival. We are not hurting them, but for 10 minutes, we get a lot of damage to the healthy cells, which we don't want. This gives us, again, where we want to operate if you want to apply for wound healing. We know it kills the bacteria, but we don't want it to kill the healthy cells. Now, the scientific questions to be answered, I don't want to go into too much detail. This is where the science we have to do to understand the interaction and what's going on the biological level. There's a lot of biology in here, so but I would like to show you this one because my student will present a paper this Wednesday on one of these activation mechanism, which is called the caspase 3, which is here. And if you activate one of these caspases, and we concentrate on this one, you can obtain the programmed cell death. So you can measure that. For example, you can see the phosphorylation of this H2AX when it damaged the DNA, then cell would like to die if their DNA is damaged. Or you can see also this caspase 3, and you see how much of that has been expressed, and you can tell if apoptosis has happened, which is the way we really want to kill these cancer cells. So if you are interested, my student will talk about that tomorrow. We have also a lot of questions on the plasma side because it's a very complex system, because you have the gas phase chemistry, and you also have the liquid phase chemistry, and you have the border between the gas phase and the liquid phase, because most of the bacteria or the mammalian cells live within liquids in a real biological system. So it's very hard and complex system to study, but people are doing that. There's a lot of modeling and simulation now being done, and a lot of diagnostics are being done to understand this very complex chemistry. With our plasma pencil, we are shooting all this reactive species into there. However, there is a lot of stuff that can happen in the liquid and from the liquid to the cells. So it's really a complicated problem, and people are working on that. To summarize, I will show you the journey so far. We went from killing bacteria to killing cancer cells, which is amazing progress. So I showed you that low temperature plasma are effective to and controlled means to inactivate bacteria, both for disinfection and also especially for antibiotic resistant bacteria. I showed you that low temperature plasma can kill cancer cells, and low doses are not toxic to fibroblasts and epithelial cells. This is for wound healing application. And the mechanism of interaction on the subcellular and molecular level, they still not well understood, so we need a lot more work. We need a lot more people like Bob who are willing to help us so and fund us so we can get to the bottom of this. So I'll show you to finish a timeline of the whole field, not just of my group. So more or less people agree that things started in 94, 95, 96 with bacteria, and then things kept progressing. And you can see that FOSR with Bob leadership really started at the beginning of the whole game. The beautiful thing about all this, and if Bob is looking at us now, that is we have basically a new milestones every 2 years in this field. So things are accelerating, the community is large enough and reaching a critical mass with that things are happening almost at a very fast speed now. There's a lot of very, very wonderful work coming out from all over the world about this. And the big thank you really goes to Bob early support, who did not just say, no, this is crazy idea, I don't want to look at it. So he played a really a major role. So I would like to thank him and thank you guys.
We have time for one question, and if Kurt wants to.